And welcome back. I hope everyone enjoyed the break. I'm Ed Bott, your host for this Microsoft Virtual Academy Windows 8.1 Jumpstart. We have a very interesting session coming up right now. So far, we've been talking about a lot of the things that are traditional parts of IT. Using desktop apps, using new style apps, deploying Windows. But for this section, we're going to talk about some new features that are enabled by a new class of devices. Windows 8 made some of these things possible. Windows 8.1 adds a whole range of new capabilities. And to help explain some of these features, we have a guest who will be familiar for anyone who watched the last session, Michael Niehaus. Welcome back.
Thanks.
And when we're done talking about this, about midway through the session, we're going to talk about another new feature of Windows 8.1, and that's going to be Windows To Go. But for right now, let's talk about some of the new features that are enabled in mobile devices. One of the most interesting ones is called Miracast.
Miracast. That's the thing that we've been saying around the studio here just to make sure that we could remember it. Miracast is a technology that's been around for a little while. It's something that Intel originally created called WiDi. For the wireless display technology, where you could take a machine and project its video without actually using a wire. So it's wireless display. Intel's WiDi was, not surprisingly, Intel-specific. But now with Miracast, it's been made into more of an industry standard. So now you can get Miracast-certified devices from a variety of different vendors so that you could use an LCD display or any of your kind of home theater type equipment as a receiver to then be able to project from a Windows device to that. So Windows 8.1 added the ability to send to a Miracast device. You just need to have an appropriate receiver. Now, if your TV or your monitor doesn't include Miracast support, they make small receivers. We've actually got one back here on the floor that we'll be using in a little bit, but they make a little receiver that you plug in and then connect via an HDMI cable to any TV or LCD display that supports a HDMI input. You can then make a Wi-Fi direct connection from your PC to the Miracast receiver and be able to see your PC display on whatever device you choose.
Okay, so a standard usage scenario for this one is I show up at your office, I've got a PowerPoint deck that I want you to see, and I have a Windows 8.1 tablet. And rather than go through the hassle of finding the mini HDMI to HDMI to, VGA, the multiple dongle scenario there, all I do is say, is that device Miracast compatible? And if it's not, then I say, well, don't worry, I've got a little receiver that I can attach to it. And we now have a Miracast compatible receiver, and we've got a device that can transmit, and we make some magic happen.
Right. And in order for that to work on a Windows 8.1 device, there does have to be the necessary hardware support,
okay,
which requires generally two pieces. There has to be a display adapter that includes Miracast support and supports a WDDM 1.3 driver, and then the wireless adapter also needs to have support for that. So your common vendors have announced support for that. Intel and Marvell and NVIDIA and ATI and others have released support for Miracast in Windows 8.1. So as long as you make sure your device supports it, then you can then talk to a receiver and project. The process that you would go through on the client side is basically to just say that I want to project and then choose the network receiver and make the connection from there. So why don't we just try that? Let's see if we can switch over to the, well, first I'll show the client side piece and then we'll want to show the actual connection on the screen behind me here. So the first thing that I would want to do is go to devices. And on the devices screen here, we can choose to project.
So what kind of, so you're using this is a conventional notebook that you've got here.
Yeah, right? I've got a Lenovo ThinkPad X1 Carbon that has the necessary hardware support for Miracast built into it. And on the screen on my laptop, you can't quite see the link at the bottom. If we can switch, I guess we can. No, that's the wrong machine in the picture-in-picture. We can switch back to my laptop there. There's actually a link that's just off the bottom of the screen that's getting cut off by the display here that says connect to a different display. And when I click that, it searches for displays that are available on the network. And hopefully it will find it. Actually, I need to add it. So we'll say that we want to add the device. And it sees my screen beam Miracast receiver here. So when I select that, it puts a message up on the screen with the PIN that I need to type in to make the pairing between the two devices. So I'll type in that number.
Okay, and on behalf of the folks who are watching this from around the world, and there's a whole bunch of you, by the way, thanks so much for coming out and joining us today. But for those who can't see, I can see the little device here, and it's probably... Oh, I would say maybe 2 inches by 2 inches by less than an inch thick. Very tiny device with an HDMI output and power to it. And the HDMI goes into this display that you see here.
Yeah, and here's the fun because it's set up as a mirrored display for me. So let's see if I can navigate my cursor and bring up an app on that screen, so it's launching my mail app, or I can cycle through other applications that are available on the screen, which requires for me to look over my shoulder at the device. But just with the particular device that we have here, it just happens to be set up to mirror because I'm using a different resolution on my laptop as on the other display, and if we tried to not mirror it, it wouldn't show up quite right. But in this case, we're just showing the exact same thing. In most cases, you'd be showing the exact same thing that was on your laptop screen on the Miracast device.
And I can attest, there are no, ladies and gentlemen, there are no wires.
And this is the little device that we're talking about. It's really not that big. It's a small Miracast receiver. It has a power connection and an HDMI connection. That's all that we need for that to work. When I disconnect that, it basically will then go back and start asking for the next device to connect. So the kind of the main scenario that we would be looking at would be one where you just have these in a conference room, in a public right. area, in your house, wherever, and be able to use that to connect whatever device wants to project at that point in time. And yeah. you talked about having to carry a whole bunch of dongles, which we do when we go to any events or anything like that. But if you've ever walked into a Microsoft conference room, they have an HDMI cable with all of those little adapters attached on a little wire ring to the cable so that you can then look at the machine and look at the cables and plug in the one that you need and attach it. And it works okay until one of them accidentally gets broken off and now that particular device can't project in that room, so you're back to carrying dongles again. So
right.
Our expectation is that we'll have one of these in every single conference room so that we can just walk in, project, and go.
Are there any limitations on the resolution that you can project from this transmitter to the Miracast receiver?
It's generally set up for a 1080p display, so generally that's going to be very high resolution compared to what you're using on most of your mobile devices, so no practical limitations. If you had a higher resolution display, maybe you have to have it mirrored so that you have the lower resolution on this display and the higher resolution laptop display, but for the most part, Windows figures out what's possible and what isn't and sets up the displays appropriately. And with something like PowerPoint that understands multi-display systems anyway, you can just tell it that I want my speaker notes on this display and I want the PowerPoint slides to go on the projector.
And if I remember correctly, you used the Windows key plus P command to get there?
Right, because I lost track of my mouse. It went floating up onto the other screen. So in order to get back to the machine where I could choose the video sources. Yeah, Windows P is the project menu, where I can then use the cursor key. So even though I couldn't find my mouse, I could still scroll around and choose the different video sources. So it does pay sometimes to know command
key
shortcuts.
Those shortcuts. Absolutely. All right, great. So now I know the next technology that we want to talk about is similar, at least in one conceptual way, and that's called Wi-Fi direct printing. And the basic concept is the same, that you have you've got a printer somewhere, and you've got a device with you, a laptop or a tablet or something, and you want to get something out of that device and onto a piece of paper and out of that printer. And you don't want to have to go through the hassle of joining the network or making a physical connection to it. So, Wi-Fi direct printing.
Yeah, I'm sure that a lot of us have gone out and bought a Wi-Fi printer and brought it home and then tried to figure out, now, how do I get that printer onto my network? Which is something that you'll go through the manual and you'll figure out how to do that once, and it'll sit there and it'll work just fine, and you'll connect over your Wi-Fi network to that. But your parents come over or a friend comes over and someone wants to print to that same printer, you then have to get their device to connect to your Wi-Fi network before it can get to the printer. But with Wi-Fi Direct, it really avoids that and allows you to go directly from your device to the printer. Just like I went directly from my laptop to the Miracast receiver. That Miracast receiver is not on the Microsoft corporate network. It just sends out a signal over Wi-Fi just to say that I'm here, anyone can talk to me. Printers would do the same thing.
It's essentially, it's similar conceptually to an ad hoc hotspot.
It is.
Except it's with a very simple, dedicated function.
And more importantly, a function that works with an established Wi-Fi connection. So your Wi-Fi adapter in the laptop can be talking, in this case to the Microsoft corporate network, and also make a Wi-Fi direct connection to one or more peripherals. So at the first level, we needed to provide Wi-Fi direct support in the operating system, which we've done for modern apps and desktop apps with APIs that we provide for that. And then we can build on top of that things like Miracast and Wi-Fi direct printing. The other piece then that is kind of helpful with that is NFC, with the near field communications tags, where you can basically take a small tag, embed some information in that, and then attach it to the device.
Okay, so now when you say a tag, that's a
physical
object.
Tag, yes.
It's made of some sort of...
I have no idea what these things
some
are made
sort of
out of.
But it's electrical...
Yeah, I'm sure you've seen them on clothing, you've seen them in stores, on higher value items. They're basically just something that can be activated by the presence of an NFC reader.
Okay.
So then you could just, when you wanted to print, you just can take your laptop up to the machine and tap it on the tag, and there can be enough of an information exchange between the tag and the device to say, this is the printer, this is the type, this is its network address, or if it's using Wi-Fi Direct, basically just connect to me, I am this device.
So now there's, yeah, and what you've described there is two different scenarios. With Wi-Fi Direct, basically any device is going to work, right?
Right.
As long as any Windows 8.1 device is going to work, because that support, as long as it has a Wi-Fi adapter and it's running Windows 8.1, that support is just built in. And
right.
You need to have a Wi-Fi direct enabled printer,
yes,
for that to work. But unlike with Miracast, where you need specific hardware support on either side, this is one where it's the printer.
Much lighter requirements.
Lighter requirements, good way of putting it. Now, with NFC, that's a little different, because both your device needs to have NFC support enabled, and
right,
you need to have that tag on the printer to make that magic happen.
Right. Yeah, so that's something that will come down the line as NFC readers become more common and as the tags become more common. But once you have those two in use, then Windows has all the pieces needed to make that work.
So, and we're likely to see that on the new generation of small mobile devices that are coming out that are running full Windows 8.1, right?
Right.
Will this be also supported in Windows RT 8.1?
It is. Basically, everything we've talked about is supported in Windows RT as well. Miracast, Wi-Fi Direct, NFC, all of those capabilities are supported by RT as well.
Great. Now, we've got another capability that we want to talk about in this session that's really important for mobile devices is support for virtual private networks, VPNs. The idea is, you know, I'm sitting here, I'm in a coffee shop, right? And I need to get to the corporate network. Every IT pro understands the pain that can be associated with making VPN connections. So there's a new feature in Windows 8.1, auto-triggered VPNs. So let's talk about that.
Yeah, and there are basically two pieces to make this work. Okay. One is some built-in VPN providers or VPN clients. So before, with Windows 8, Windows 7 back, you would have to go out, download the necessary VPN client, and install that onto your Windows operating system before you can make the connection.
And most likely, an IT pro, one of the people in our audience, would have had to have done that for a whole bunch of employees in the organization.
Yeah, and frequently they would be built into the image that you deploy so that they don't have to do that machine by machine. They just make sure it's available on all of them, which work great for enterprise-owned devices with enterprise images on them, but for your home machine, your home laptop, more of the BYOD scenarios, or even Windows RT devices where you can't put your own custom image or custom desktop app on it, that became more problematic. So by building them into the OS, working together with the VPN vendors to create these clients, we can greatly simplify that. So let's switch over to the demo machine again, and let's look at what this first piece would look like. So first we need to get to the place where we can add a VPN connection. And there are a couple of ways to do that. The normal way would be to bring up the charms and then click on Change PC Settings, which brings us here, where we can then click on Network and then add a VPN connection. And built into Windows 8.1 are VPN clients for Checkpoint, F5, Juniper, Microsoft, and SonicWall. So we don't need to install any separate clients. They're already there. In this case, I'm going to make a connection to a Microsoft Windows Server 2012 R2 VPN server. I'm going to call this Contoso and specify contosovpn.com, which is the address of my VPN server. I'll sign in with a username and password.
Although you would have the option to use a smart card there, right?
I could, yeah. I could use a smart card. I could use a one-time password, which is kind of like the token-based authentication. Yeah. But in this case, I'll keep it simple. Username and password. And I'll put in those details. Actually, let's just leave those off. Since they are optional, we'll see what happens when they're not there. So I've added the VPN connection, and now I can go to make that connection just by clicking on the available connections, finding that, and connecting. And now, of course, it asks me to type in my user ID and password. And now I have a VPN connection to my internal network. So that's the first piece. So we've got the clients built in, and we can easily go through the modern UI and create a new connection.
And that's a simplified version of a scenario that people should be pretty familiar with already. This is using the new Windows 8.x interface, but otherwise fairly straightforward.
Yeah. So the next piece then is, I want to take that VPN connection, and instead of trying to teach the users that before you go to this website, you need to make a VPN connection first, or before you run this app, you need to make a VPN connection first, we can instead define auto triggers. So we can put a trigger on that says anytime the user accesses this particular web page, or anytime they run this app.
Their CRM app, for example.
Yeah, it'll make the VPN connection for them. So in order to do that, we need to look at the available PowerShell commands. So if we look at PowerShell commandlets for VPN connections. We can create them via PowerShell. We can get them. We can modify them. In this case, we want to set the VPN connection Actually, let's just do get VPN connection. So there's my connection name. It shows the details associated with that. I just want to modify that to specify split tunneling, because that's actually required for this auto-triggered VPN. So I'll modify that setting. And then I want to add a VPN connection triggered application.
Uh-huh.
So I can say that for that connection called Contoso, I want to specify the application ID that should automatically invoke that connection. And that could be, let me just, if I type get appx package, we can see all of the apps that are currently installed.
So do you need a GUID for that?
You need the app ID.
Okay.
Which is the name, I believe. Yeah, so that would be the app ID, would be something like Microsoft.bingmaps. But you can also specify an executable. So if it isn't a modern application, maybe it's an existing desktop app, you can just specify the path to the executable. So I can do add VPN connection triggered application to use the connection called Contoso. I'll specify an application ID of /windows/system32/notepad.exe. So it says auto-triggering will be turned off because you have disabled auto-triggering. You can manually turn on auto-triggering for this VPN profile in the network's list. So what that's telling me is the user has to basically give permission to auto-trigger by checking this box that now shows up to say, let apps automatically use this VPN connection.
So had you turned that option on without doing that work first,
nothing would have happened.
Nothing would happen.
Right.
You'd enable something, but there'd be no configuration accomplished.
Yeah, so now we can see we don't have a VPN connection. We could manually connect, but that kind of defeats the purpose. But now if I just ran Windows System 32 notepad.exe, notepad launches, and we have a VPN connection. So just by the process of that launching, it made the connection. It remembered the details of the account and password when I had connected before, so I didn't need to type that in again.
And so the payoff here is that you've dramatically reduced the possibility that a user is going to make an unsafe connection where data can be intercepted, or have to go through a complicated and potentially frustrating process of oh yeah, I tried to run this app, but it said I had to make a VPN connection, and I'm not.
Don't have to understand how it all works.
They just
do their work.
Just do what they're accustomed to.
So that's the first piece. Now, if we disconnect, and then again say that we want to let apps use it, we could add a trigger based on something else. So we could say based on a DNS configuration, again specifying the connection name Contoso, the DNS suffix of contoso.com with the DNS IP address of 10.81.1.1. We now have another trigger that basically says anytime you go to a website or anything that accesses contoso.com, we want to establish that same connection. So here if I go to internal.contoso.com, the web page comes up. If we look at our VPN connection, it's been reestablished so that that would work. if I were to disconnect that and then try to refresh the page, then it wouldn't work anymore. So it's fairly easy to set up these connection triggers for an IT pro using PowerShell.
Right.
But you don't want to do that on thousands of machines. It's something that you really want to automate. That's where MDM comes in, mobile device management, which Martin will talk about later this afternoon, where you can define these triggers in the mobile device management cloud and have those pushed down to a device so that the user never has to worry about this. They just enroll the device into mobile device management and the IT pro can push out those triggers to the device.
And these devices are not fully managed domain joined devices. They're just...
They might not even be company owned. They could be the user's own devices. They allow lightweight management of them via MDM to enforce company security policies, to provide certificates so that they can make secure connections, to create VPN connections and the auto triggers that go along with it, and maybe push out some applications if there are some company created modern apps that the user might want on their own machines to do some work from their personal device. So that's really the purpose of MDM, and Martin will get into much more detail around that. But it really then makes this VPN configuration fairly straightforward for the end user because the MDM provider takes care of it for you. But showing the PowerShell just shows what's going on behind the scenes and how those different pieces work.
Great. And one final feature you want to talk about that's interesting for mobile devices is the mobile broadband.
Yeah, and the main thing with mobile broadband is you kind of want it to work like your phone. You want to be able to put it into airplane mode when you're getting onto an airplane. You want to be able to monitor your usage because you probably have a limited amount of quota on the particular broadband account that you have. So you want to be able to prevent things like Windows going out and downloading 15 app updates while you're connected over mobile broadband. So we've built in awareness in Windows to when you're connected over a metered connection and when you're not connected over a metered connection, and we can do the right things in the right times. So you can say, don't do these types of things over metered connections. Apps can also be aware of that. So an app could choose, well, if I'm on a metered connection, I want to give you kind of a lightweight experience versus going out and downloading 100 mega pictures or something like that first time it's launched.
So a file synchronization utility, for example, would be a good thing. You know, I'm gonna stop syncing your file store with the cloud now until you're back on an unmetered connection.
Right, and then also just having a basic understanding that metered connections are more expensive than unmetered connections. When you drift into range of a Wi-Fi connection, you probably want to switch over to that Wi-Fi connection. So Windows will take care of doing that and have the metered connection disconnect for a while. And then when you go outside of the range of that Wi-Fi connection, okay, now you need the metered connection again. So it can manage the connections appropriately so that you minimize the amount of network traffic that's being generated.
Great. Well, thanks very much, Michael. And I think now we're going to switch gears. And we're going to talk about a different technology, but while we're getting set up for that, I want to do a little bit of housekeeping. First of all, a little bit about me and where you can find some of the things I've written. My most recent book from Microsoft Press, Introducing Windows 8.1 for IT Professionals. It's available for free. You'll see the links for it in the slides that are in between the sessions today. It's a free download in ebook format. That's PDF, Mobi for Kindles, and EPUB for other types of reader devices. If you want a printed copy, printed copies are available for a reasonable price, but the EPUB ebook versions work very well. And that book covers all of the topics that we're covering in today's five sessions. So it starts with the user experience, goes through a lot of the deployment techniques, the management and mobility stuff. You can also, if you have questions for me, if you want to talk to me directly, you can do that. Probably one of the best places to reach me is on Twitter. I am at edbot. E-D, B as in boy, O-T-T, on Twitter. So you're welcome to reach me there. I have a fairly active presence there. And you can also find me at zdnet.com/blog/bot, B-O-T-T. And that's where you'll find what I've been up to lately, where I've been writing a lot about Windows 8.1 lately, and will continue to do so. With that housekeeping out of the way, Michael Raymond joins us.
Hi.
Hi, Michael.
Hi, thank you.
And Michael is going to talk about a technology that was new. I think it was new in Windows 8.
Correct. It
right.
was new for Windows 8.
And so it's, but there are some really key refinements in Windows 8.1. But I have this prop here. This looks like a familiar USB drive. It's a little bigger than most of the ones that you'll see. And if you open this up and you look here, you'll see that it has the characteristic blue connector, and that means this is a USB 3.0 device. But this device is a little different from your standard USB drive. What makes this one different?
So what makes these different for and suitable for Windows to go is we've have very specific hardware requirements, specifically around performance and size, minimum size requirements. For Windows to go, we have a minimum size requirement of 32 gigabytes. And then we also require that it has, it passes HCK requirements for Windows to say that this device specifically it will work well for the operating system.
Okay, so these are high-performance devices, at least the ones that I have. In fact, I have one just like this at home. It's 32 gigabytes. This is 64 gigabytes. And so the idea is that you are running Windows 8.1 Enterprise there, and you can, whoops, I dropped that, sent that flying there. But you can take and you can turn this into basically a Windows 8.1 Enterprise PC.
Right? Absolutely.
Okay, how does that work?
Well, and the wonderful thing about it is that so you've put your entire hard drive on the USB drive itself. So what it does is rather than use the internal hard drive of your computer, or for instance, your laptop, for instance, we boot directly to the USB drive and use all of your applications. All of your settings, everything is on the USB drive. This also has the benefit of whenever you roam to a different machine, all of your applications, settings, and everything roam with you. So you don't have to set up anything new for that new machine. Your computer, as it was, is all on the USB drive. So I can use any machine as my machine. I can just boot up on this laptop, or if I want to say go across the country, rather than have to take a laptop with me, I can just take this, you know, 2 ounce, 5 ounce USB drive, stick that in my pocket, and then any computer I encounter, I can boot directly to that USB drive, and it doesn't affect the machine. We don't even mount the hard drive of the host computer. We only mount the USB drive and any other external USB drives that you might connect to the machine so that you protect the host machine. You're not going to interfere with it. You're also not going to, if for instance the machine had some malware installed on the hard drive, you're bypassing that because you're booting directly to the USB drive. And then I can use that machine, you know, on the other side of the country as my machine that I had on, you know, here in Seattle, and I can have it configured for direct access. I can have it set up for everything else. So I'm in my exact same environment that I had before.
And when you, so you come into my office and say, Ed, I need to borrow your computer. Say, yeah, I'm sorry, you're not borrowing my computer. Nobody borrows my computer because, you know, I don't know what you're going to do with it. And you say, no, turn it off and we'll turn it back on and we'll boot from this. And everything that happens is happening on this drive. And when you shut down, there's no trace left behind on my computer. You've never had any contact with my data. You've never had any contact with my apps. You haven't left any temporary files behind on my drive. Everything stayed on this device.
Exactly. And so we leave no footprint at all. It's like I was never even there. And then the even better part is that, for instance, let's say you had a managed machine, we're not interfering with any of the group policies that you might have set. We're not interfering with even if you were encrypted. And actually, that would be even better. If your hard drive is encrypted, then even if I'm booting off of my Windows to Go drive, I can't access anything on your machine. I'm booted to my machine, which could be managed by an entirely different organization. So I'm joined to my domain. I've got my set of policies that I have to apply to. And it creates a nice, seamless experience that you wouldn't even notice.
Okay, so now this requires Windows 8.1 Enterprise.
Correct.
Right. Are there any other requirements? Is this a software assurance benefit?
Yes, this is something that you need for with software assurance. The reason for that is licensing. And the reason why you need that is because of the roaming that I explained a little bit earlier. So the ability to roam to any machine that you could possibly want to, software assurance gives you that capability so that I can go from this machine here, I can go down the hall to another machine, I can go as many machines as I can potentially boot to, and I have no licensing problems whatsoever.
Okay, so just want to make sure that the viewers have their expectations set. If you're running Windows 8.1 Pro, you won't be able to demo this for you. You won't be able to try this for yourself. You need the Enterprise SKU and the appropriate licensing.
Correct. We do allow the Enterprise Eval Edition allows you to install. So you could install the Eval Edition on a Windows to Go drive to try it out, and that does allow you to demonstrate and is an easy way for you to try out Windows 8.1 and also try out Windows to Go at the same time.
Okay, now, for this is very similar in functioning to how it worked in Windows 8. There is one significant new feature in Windows 8.1, right? That's the Windows Store support?
Correct. So what we've done in Windows 8, you could enable the store. However, if you did so, you would no longer be able to roam without disabling all of your new Windows Store applications. You'd have problems with them continuing to work.
Which slightly defeats the purpose of Windows to Go.
Yes, it does. So what we did is we spent some time for Windows 8.1, we added full Windows Store support so that now it's enabled by default, and you can install applications just like you would normally on your machine, but now as you roam, all of your store applications just work.
Great. So why don't we do a demo? Why don't you show us how this works?
Sure. So the first demo I'm going to show is the cleanest and easiest way to provision a Windows to Go drive.
Okay.
And so what we have here, this is the Windows to Go Creator. This application is on all Enterprise machines, and
all you have to do to get to this is Windows key plus S and type Windows to Go, and this will just show up.
Correct. And when you do that search for Windows to Go, the first search result is actually the Windows to Go startup options, which allows you to set your host machine to automatically boot to Windows to Go drives. And then the second option is the Windows to Go
Creator.
Okay. Yes. So this Windows to Go Creator here, the first screen that it shows up lists all of the Windows or all of the USB drives that are connected to the machine. This one just has the one Kingston device that you had shown earlier. This one is a 32 gigabyte. And now it allows me to select an image. I have, for the sake of this demo, put in a under my images folder a test image that's running. It's running Enterprise, but the nice thing is that it's not going to take very long to provision. This should only take about 30 seconds or so. Any real image that you had would probably take 10 to 20 minutes to provision, especially if you had installed other Enterprise applications such as Office.
Okay.
So we select that image, and now here's something that's really nice. We can actually encrypt the Windows to Go drive with BitLocker. And I can set a password, if I can type correctly. And so what this does is this will encrypt the USB drive with BitLocker using a password protector. So because the Windows to Go drive can roam to several different machines, we can't use the TPM for BitLocker encryption. But instead, what we did for Windows to Go is we enabled the password protector so we can still get that password, we can still have the BitLocker encryption to protect the drive. And then it gives us a final, are you really ready to do this? Because we're going to destroy any data that's currently on this drive. And then it goes through a few steps, prepares, gets everything ready for the disk, and then it will start provisioning the drive. And then because I'm using a very, very tiny test image, this will only take about 30 seconds. And then I can show you the final page on this, which is essentially what we referenced earlier for the Windows to Go startup options allows you to specify if you want this host machine to automatically boot two Windows to Go drives whenever one is connected and you reboot the machine.
Right.
So, and you can see it's already finished. This will not happen normally. So, and as you can see here on this machine, the Windows to Go options are not currently set to boot automatically. We could say yes, and then we could save and restart and boot to that drive, but we're not going to do that for now. So we'll just save and close. And that's the end of the provisioning demo. So that is one way that we can use to deploy Windows to Go. And the Creator is an excellent mechanism for creating a single Windows to Go drive. So if I want to try it out and I want to see some of the capabilities, not just for Windows to Go, but for Windows 8. So if you're in an enterprise that only has Windows 7 or even XP, and you want to see, well, what does Windows 8 do for me? I can deploy Windows to Go and try it out on a machine without touching the operating system that's currently there. It's a great way to evaluate the OS. But so in addition, for ways of deploying for larger deployments, we also have SCCM. We have built-in support for deploying scripts there that allow you to do provisioning for many, many machines. We have PowerShell scripts that we have available as demonstrations that show how you could do one or many drives. Then that allows you to quickly do very many interesting things, such as not just provision the drive, but you can also enable BitLocker like we showed. You can do an offline domain join,
right,
which is very useful in some cases. And you can also set up other things, like you can inject different drivers into the image. You can do offline application installations. Some very interesting things there. And then finally, another good deployment mechanism we have available is duplication. So once you've created a single drive, for instance, with the PW Creator that I just showed, you can then use a USB duplicator to quickly replicate that image to many machines. So for instance, in my office, I've got an 8-port duplicator. So after I've created my single device, I can then connect it to the duplicator, and then I can make 8 more in a matter of minutes, which is really nice. So that's really useful.
So now, once this is done, I'm working for you, and you've given this to me and said, Ed, you can take this and you go out to our satellite office there, but you don't need to carry your notebook with you. This is all you need. And I can plug this into, now if I plug this into a USB 3.0 port on a fairly modern device, I'm going to get excellent performance. But if satellite office happens to have a couple of old machines that only have USB 2.0 ports, this will still run?
Absolutely. It'll still run. You will notice some performance degradation, but it's still completely usable. And provided that you have the expectation of, oh, I'm connected to USB 2, you might not even necessarily notice some of the things. Because as soon as, boot might take a little bit longer, but once you've booted, a lot of everything is running just in memory. So you wouldn't notice the performance as much. But definitely you would get your best performance on USB 3.
Okay. And are there any limitations? Are there any features of Windows 8.1 that I can't use when I'm running Windows to Go?
There are a few a few things on with Windows to Go that we've had to disable for. So, for instance, the recovery environment is disabled by default. That does not work.
That sort of makes sense because the idea that you're going to reset this device is, I mean, if you're going to reset it, you just go rebuild it or reduplicate it.
Correct. And it also is usually it's undefined what it really means to recover a Windows to Go drive. Another feature that's disabled by default is Hibernate. Since we don't necessarily know, okay, I hibernated on one machine and then I moved to another machine and I try to resume from Hibernate. Well, what does that mean? I'm not really sure. So that feature is also disabled. And then, as we talked before, the TPM chip is disabled on the drive so that you can't, since the TPM is really hardware-based, you can't use the TPM for BitLocker because the hardware is going to change. As soon as I roam to another machine, it's no longer going to be valid.
But in all other senses, with Windows 8.1, if I plug this into my notebook and reboot the machine from this drive, I'm running Windows 8.1 Enterprise.
Yes, and that's the real goal for the feature is that it's just Windows. There's no difference between Windows 8.1 on a standard host machine versus running it off of the USB drive.
Great. Anything else we need to know about Windows to Go?
Yes. Two kind of big things. So the other main feature that we changed for Windows 8.1 was the ability to boot from a composite drive. So a composite USB drive is essentially a USB drive that does more than one thing. And in this case, what we did is we enabled the ability to boot a USB drive that contains not just the mass storage device, but a built-in smart card. So one of the new devices that we have now from Spyrus is this device here. And this comes in both a hardware encrypted USB drive and a non-encrypted, but it also contains a built-in embedded smart card. So in addition to being able to boot from this drive, I can also have my smart card on this, so I can then use my smart card login. So instead of having to carry my USB drive and a smart card reader and a smart card, I now just have my one single USB drive. And that's very useful for a scenario for such as like direct access, where I might be using my smart card for authentication. I can now just boot from my drive, log in with my smart card, connect to direct access, and it uses the certificates built into that smart card, and I'm all set.
And those drives are brand new, right?
Yes, we actually just certified these earlier this week. Okay. So they're brand new. It's a very kind of neat new device. And an additional benefit is the smart card is actually accessible even if you're not booted from it. So let's say I wanted to just use my smart card to do a login on any machine. I could just connect this USB drive to a machine and log in with the smart card on this drive without actually touching the Windows to Go storage partition on the drive at all.
Excellent. That it?
That's everything I
That's a lot.
That is a lot.
It's a fascinating feature. I remember when Windows 8 came out and I first heard about this feature, I kind of scratched my head. But having built a few of these myself and then used them, you understand. Now, just to put this in perspective for the IT pros watching this is not something that is going to be appropriate for everyone in the world. There are kind of specific user scenarios where this is appropriate. But for those scenarios, for roaming workers who need a secure, easy to access environment, it's a really interesting solution and one that you should consider looking into. So, Michael, thanks very much.
Thank you.
And we're going to take another little break right now, and it's going to be about 10 minutes. And after that, we're going to come back for the day's final session.